good evening to all the participants and the organizers. I would like to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. It's a very interesting topic, a rather unheard topic, forgive the pun. So I really enjoyed preparing for this topic, and it made me look at boys in a different light, you know, a different perspective, because we never give a second thought to boys. So if you think about it, voice is one's identity. Your vocal print is like your fingerprint. It's very unique. And when you hear somebody's voice, you can immediately recognize them. And even if you've never met a person, so when you listen to a voice, you can make an educated guess about their gender, their age, and from the way they speak, how educated they are and where they are from. So you can gather a lot of information from one's voice. And many of us make a living out of our voices. So what is voice? It's nothing but its sound that is produced by the vocal instrument. And like any instrument, a musical instrument, you need a power source which pushes the air across a vibrating body, and that is further modified in a resonating chamber. So this is how a sound is produced. So here the respiratory power source are the lungs, our chest muscles and the diaphragm, which push the air across the vibrating body, which is the vocal cord, which is further modified by the oral cavity, the nasal cavity. And when we speak, we modify it further with our lips and tongue and teeth. So that is how we produce voice or speech. So speech or voice has several interesting characters. The one that all of us can instantly identify, and the most important one, is the pitch of the voice, which is determined by the fundamental frequency at which the vibrations happen. So males have a deeper, low-pitched voice, when females have a higher and high-pitched voice with a frequency of about 190 to 220 hertz. And there's a range in between where it is gender ambiguous. This is important for us to remember, because later we'll see that when we're dealing with patients who are undergoing gender transformation, this is very important. So why is that males and females have different voice pitches? One would wonder. So this is called sexual dimorphism, and voice is a highly sexually dimorphic feature, especially in humans. So if you think about it, nature has one agenda for all of us, for all species, that is to reproduce. And unfortunately, it's a little unfair on the males, and because the onus of successful reproduction falls on the males of the species. So they need to have some trait to woo the female of the species. If you look at birds, they have really colorful feathers. They dance and sing and woo the female. In primates, it's the voice. So studies of evolution show that in primates, having a deep voice in a male provided a distinctive reproductive advantage and ensured successful reproduction. So it's not surprising that this trait has been selected and has been developed over centuries. And now as humans, we are one of the highly sexually dimorphic when it comes to voice. In fact, voice even today plays a very important role in our social lives, because people with deeper voices, both men and women, are perceived to have higher social power in terms of leadership abilities. They are perceived as more capable and more dominant. So voice affects us even today in our social lives. So how does this difference happen in voice? And it all comes down to our gonads, our testosterone synthesis. So estrogen and progesterone also have an influence on voice, but it is not as dramatic as that of testosterone. So during puberty, when there's a surge in testosterone levels, the whole vocal apparatus undergoes a series of changes. So the vocal cords increase in length, they become thicker and wider, but they remain lax. The muscles hypertrophy, the mucosa thickens, and the thyroid cartilage develops the characteristic Adam's apple by becoming narrower. The cricothyroid membrane widens, and the corresponding muscles also become more powerful. With this, we have the strengthening of the chest muscles, which gives the force and power to push the air through the larynx. So all these changes put together result in cracking of the voice, and the voice becomes deeper and they're unable to achieve a higher octaves. So this is called the cracking of voice, which is a highly significant event in the secondary sexual character development in males, and it is considered an equivalent of menarche in women. It's very important here to remember that the changes introduced by testosterone is irreversible. This is very important because in women who have been exposed to androgens, and in males when they're transforming to females, these changes are permanent, and hence we need to be very careful when dealing with them. So the permanency of these effects, interestingly, were observed several centuries ago. And in Italy, like the last picture that Dr. Spurti showed you in the quiz, so the Catholic Church did not allow women to be a part of their choir, but they still liked the feminine voice to be a part of the choir. So what they would do is they would castrate young boys with exceptional musical qualities in order to preserve the high-pitched prepubertal voice. So what happens in women during puberty? They also undergo a few changes under the influence of estrogen, progesterone, but it is not as dramatic as that of testosterone. So the vocal muscle thickens very slightly, but it remains very supple and elastic, but there is little development of the cartilage or the membrane. So this results in a slight drop in the pitch when compared to the prepubertal levels. But the mucosa is still dependent on hormones. So that is why women can develop a premenstrual vocal syndrome, where there is voice fatigue, a reduction in the range of the pitch, loss of power, and especially noticeable in singers where they cannot achieve high pitches and they cannot sing properly a few days before their menstruation. So an examination of the vocal cord at this time will show there is congestion, varices, and edema of the vocal cords. During menopause, there is a reduction in the level of estrogen and a relative increase in the levels of androgens, which can again lower voice intensity, cause voice fatigue, and reduce the range of voice pitch and loss of vocal quality. So this is due to vocal muscle atrophy and reduction in thickness of the mucosa, and also reduced mobility of the joints of the throat. Interestingly, hormone replacement therapy can improve these vocal symptoms in postmenopausal women. In children with Turner syndrome, because they are short, they have a smaller larynx, and some of them have partial androgen insufficiency. So they tend to have a really high-pitched voice at presentation. So treatment with growth hormone, because later we would see that growth hormone influences the development of the maxilla and the mandible. So that, along with oxandrolone, which is an anabolic steroid, which is not very often used, but sometimes in the West they do. It's often combined with growth hormone to promote height. So these children, when they receive oxandrolone, can notice a deepening of voice, which happens in a dose-dependent manner. The other group of conditions where voice becomes important is when we are dealing with a woman with signs of androgenization. So patients come to us with hirsutism, increased body hair growth, facial hair growth. But what distinguishes it, what tells us that this is something very sinister and serious, is a voice change. Because you need to have a threshold level of androgen, usually more than 200 nanograms per deal, with a significant duration of exposure for your voice to change. So when a woman presents with signs of androgenization and there is a voice change, that should tell you that this is something sinister, this is something serious, far more than, this is not just simple PCOS. So that is when we should look for serious causes like tumors and CAH. So we are increasingly seeing patients who want to undergo gender reassignment, and voice is a very important part of gender reassignment because voice is our identity. And when we transform, when we reassign them to a different gender, their voice has to be gender congruent. So the treatment, what we give, mainly focuses on modifying pitch, but pitch is just one aspect of voice. So what we should remember is that we can modify the pitch of the voice, but that does not guarantee gender congruence. So here we should remember that there should be successful behavioral therapy and voice therapy so that they can modify their airflow, modify their voice, and because they need to change their intensity, the intonation, the resonance. There are so many other features of voice that tells us whether it's masculine or feminine. So interestingly, a lot of these patients, even after hormonal interventions or surgeries, fail something called a telephone test. What's a telephone test? You talk to somebody over a telephone and they have to identify the gender of the person because you're taking away all the other cues that will help you in determining gender. So many times, even if the pitch range that is needed is achieved, many of these patients fail a telephone test because the other features give away, like the intonation, their intensity. So a feminine voice is supposed to be less loud and they have a greater pitch variability, but a masculine voice is supposed to be more monotonous. They have a less range in pitch and they're generally louder. So these are certain aspects that we should remember when treating patients who are undergoing gender reassignment. So female to male gender reassignment in terms of voice management is definitely easier because you have a good response with testosterone treatment. The voice deepening happens soon after and it's initiating therapy. And maximum voice change happens during the first year. And subsequently, there isn't much change. But by the end of 1 year, the voice is very comparable to that of biological males. And testosterone alone can reduce your fundamental frequency, but that's the pitch of the voice, by 70 hertz. And this would bring it within the gender ambiguous range that we talked about earlier, which is what we are hoping to achieve. So the response to androgens is not uniform in all of these women. And there is a correlation with the number of the CAG repeats in the androgen receptor, which will determine the androgen sensitivity. So if there is reduced androgen sensitivity, there may not be a very dramatic or as a change that we would expect. So they can still have some problems with voice and pitch. This is where voice therapy becomes very, very important. Very, very rarely, they would require surgeries where a type 3 thyroplasty, where the thyroid cartilage is removed. This will then relax the vocal cord and produce the pitch. Voice modification in male transforming to a female gender is definitely a lot trickier because, as we saw, the changes due to testosterone are often permanent and cannot be reversed. So when we replace or give them estrogens with HRT, they do not develop significant female voice. However, how they perceive their voice, that is the self-perception of voice, surprisingly improves with HRT. This is because of the other biological changes that happens with HRT. So they are able to since there are biological changes, they perceive themselves as more feminine. So their perception about voice also improves. So it is advisable to give HRT for a few months, for at least 6 months, before invasive voice intervention is considered. Voice therapy, again, is very, very important because they can change the resonance of the voice by just moving their tongue. Like, simple maneuvers are taught where they can move, reduce the space within the oral cavity, and they can adjust the voice that is produced. Phonosurgery or the surgical management becomes an important part of treatment here. So historically, earlier, the surgery involved altering the structure of the larynx. So you are suturing the thyroid cartilage to the cricoid cartilage to increase the tension. You are basically modifying the structure of the larynx. So today, it is not as invasive. There are endoscopic approaches. A few endoscopic approaches that are used are where the epithelium of the anterior third of the cord is removed and you apply something called the voice gel, which will result in the formation of a web and reduces the length of the vocal cord. So we have carbon dioxide laser, which is being used to reduce the mass of the vocal cords so they become thinner and lighter. There's a surgical procedure called glottoplasty, where the vocal cords are sutured and hence the length is shortened. As we said earlier, many of them fail the telephone test postoperatively, even though these results of the surgery per se are successful. So this emphasizes the need for continuing voice therapy. So these are some of the pictures that show of the glottoplasty procedure itself. In B here, we can see that the epithelium is denuded and some sutures are put in. And postoperatively, you can see a reduction in the size of the vocal cord from the preoperative size in panel A. So the gonadal hormones, no doubt, have profound effects on voice, and in various disorders, voice is affected. The other hormone that can influence voice is growth hormone, because it affects craniofacial development. And the pitch of your voice correlates with the size of the maxilla and the mandible, and to some amount, the soft tissues. So growth hormone can affect the size of mandible and maxilla. And we often see that children with very severe growth hormone deficiency have mid-phase hypoplasia. So they have very high-pitched voice, which is seen in both genders, and it is present across lifespan, especially when they are not treated. What happens in growth hormone excess? So there is an overgrowth of the bone, overgrowth of the soft tissue component of the throat. There is thickening of the vocal cords. The laryngeal mucosa becomes very lax. And they can also have problems with the cartilage and the joint. And there is arytenoid cartilage dislocation, which is very commonly seen in these patients and a few other endocrinological conditions. So all of these changes, along with the expansion of the sinuses, we saw that the sinuses in the nasal cavity can modify voice. So all of these changes put together will result in a lower pitch, hoarse, sonorous voice in acromegaly. So most of these treatments, especially the edema and the hypertrophy part, tends to reduce with surgery and medical management, and it can reduce the voice handicap that these patients have. We all know about thyroid and how hypothyroidism can cause hoarseness of voice. And I think that's been, we've been hearing that from our undergraduate days. Yeah. So there is a lot of deposition of mucopolysaccharide with all over the body, especially in the vocal cords, which tends to retain water. And so there is edema of the cords, edema of the cricothyroid muscles and the vagus nerve also, which can result in hoarseness, low voice, reduced range, and voice fatigue. A less common cause of voice change that is related to endocrinology would be hyperthyroidism, which can also cause hoarseness of voice and can produce trembling of voice, and you can even lose your voice, or aphonia has been reported with hyperthyroidism. Like Dr. I had introduced at the beginning of the topic. So patients who are undergoing thyroid or parathyroid surgeries, voice is a very important issue. It can have medical legal consequences also. So it is routinely attributed to recurrent laryngeal nerve palsy. However, not all patients have recurrent laryngeal palsy. They can have an injury to the superior laryngeal nerve, which is the tensor of the vocal cord. So when that is injured, they cannot reach higher pitch. So they cannot shout, they cannot sing high pitches. So it is not always due to recurrent laryngeal nerve palsy. And there are less other causes of voice change as well, which is can be a damage to the superior laryngeal nerve, which is not often recognized. It can just be a result of the intubation. It can be due to the stretching of the strap muscles, which happens during surgery, or it can be due to the laryngeal venous drainage, which is altered during the surgery. So this means that there are other reasons for voice change. The good news is that less than 10% of them are permanent, and not everybody has recurrent laryngeal nerve palsy, not all patients with recurrent laryngeal nerve palsy have voice change. It's very important to assess the right etiology and to reassure the patient, because most often it resolves on its own. So neuromonitoring intraoperatively will help in identifying and isolating these nerves and can greatly reduce the risk of voice damage that can happen with surgical procedures. So I hope I have summarized all of the endocrine causes and how our hormones can influence one's voice in health and sickness. It was a very interesting topic for me, and I believe that because voice is one's identity, it tells us a lot about a person. It's very important for us as endocrinologists to recognize the importance of voice, identify how voice can be affected in various endocrinological problems, and try and fix it. Involve our colleagues and friends, take the help of voice therapy and our ENT colleagues to fix complex situations. Thank you so much.
So thank you, Nandini.